Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Compensation Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of compensation that govern the operation of God's laws, gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 23rd of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
That was the best Q&A session I've had for a long time. That was really good. Thanks, guys. It's lovely asking intelligent questions, answering intelligent questions, I should say. Okay. Also got quite a lot in this discussion, as you can imagine, so we will approach this discussion the same way we've done all the other principles thus far, and that is I'll present sort of the summary in a few terms, and we'll do some of the notes section too, because that's where some of you have quite a large number of questions, so we can handle that straight away, and then we'll get to your questions on the sheet. So this is the compensation principles discussion. Another fascinating principle of God's. Let's have a look at it. So again, will-based, so we'll be looking at that in relation to the human soul. Of course, other creatures are compensated. It's not just the human soul that gets compensated, but the other creatures are also compensated. So we can sort of see how that works too as part of your questioning. Of course, we're talking about the human soul again with regard to these principles. Remember the self-responsibility definition. So by now you should be starting to get quite used to this definition, that it's based upon desire for self-awareness, desire for love, truth, and to live in harmony with the principles, but also this factor of loving ownership and expression of one's will, desire, and passions and emotions, attitudes, intentions, and so forth, in harmony with God's principles. So by now you should be getting quite comfortable with that concept of what self-responsibility is all about from God's perspective. Can you see its importance? Because now we've examined it. We started examining it yesterday afternoon with the responsibility principles, but you can starting to see that pretty much all the principles from now on are going to be focused on this self-responsibility, which is all about this desire. And in fact, one of God's principles is all about desire. And remember in the previous Q&A, some of those questions about desire, a bit surprising, hey? How God's measuring not the action or the effect of the action, but rather the desire and the effect of the desire. So that's really interesting. So let's look at what compensation is. Compensation is the reward provided to the soul and its environment for self-responsibility, or the corrective penalty enforced upon the soul and its environment for the disobedience or the lack of self-responsibility. So it's not just measuring obedience versus disobedience. It's to obey one of God's laws, you have to have a desire to obey it. That's a part of what it means to be obedient, that an actual desire exists in you to obey it. Right? So that's a very interesting concept that most of us have not given too much thought to, actually. The reason why we know that is because many of us have engaged another facade trying to obey God's laws, but not examined, why don't I feel like obeying God's laws? And God's laws measure the feelings, not just the action. In fact, God's laws are very, very much disposed towards correcting the feeling that causes an unloving action. So you can see, and also, by the way, I must suggest here, God's laws are also rewarding the feelings, whether in harmony with love, whether actions resulted or not. So that's interesting too. Okay, so let's look at the principles. What do they do? These conversation principles, the purpose of them is firstly to educate the human soul about sin. So without compensation, you wouldn't really know what sin is. With compensation, there is a cause and effect which allows you to measure the results of sin and therefore know that sin causes damage. And therefore also know that good deeds or sinless feelings create positive outcomes, happiness and joy, for example. They provide compensation, which is in the form of a reward or a correction to the soul. And remember, all compensation is loving. So many of you have talked to me in the past about the law of attraction and saying, oh, my, you know, law of attraction was really terrible. And I'm going, how can it be terrible but loving? It can't be, can it? Your idea of what terrible is obviously needs to change. Does that make sense? It ensures self-responsibility is the measure for compensation. Now, this is a very interesting aspect of compensation. So basically what we're saying is the self-responsibility part of this principle is very important. It actually measures self-responsibility and then provides compensation based upon whether the soul is self-responsible or lacks self-responsibility. Remembering that self-responsibility is the law-based requirement to seek, desire these things. Self-awareness, seeking truth and love. You can see straight away that really what the law is starting to show us, and some of the future principles will obviously demonstrate to us, that everything's about what desire, what you desire, what your intention is. It's not just about what you choose to do, but rather what was your intention in doing it. Right? We see that this is an interesting aspect of compensation. You see, many times you take actions with the intention of getting a reward. That's not a pure desire. So it's out of harmony with the self-responsibility principle. Therefore, there won't be a positive reward. And then you go, but there's no positive rewards for doing the right thing. Well, of course there's not if you do it that way. There won't be any positive rewards if you do it that way. You follow? Because your intention was to get the reward. So isn't that a selfish intention? Surely it is it not? If you have a selfish intention, what's the laws trying to do? Correct your selfish intention. So you can actually engage the law thinking that you're obeying it, while at the same time your intention being only to get the reward from obeying it, and now you're breaking it. And God is trying to correct the fact that your intention was out of harmony with love. You see? So this is where we got to understand this really well, don't we? We've got to get this principle really well. Otherwise, we'll be going around like a mad thing, doing what the facade dictates to do, you know, just do everything that's right, do it right, do it right, do it right, do it right, getting no rewards and going, stuff this at the end of the day. How angry are you going to get with that? You say, I'm doing everything right and still getting hammered by the law. You see? And that's true, you are. Because the law is measuring your intention, the purity of your desire. Yeah. Which also, if you think about it, has some really positive things to it, does it not? If you can fix up the purity of your intention, then imagine how many rewards are going to come as a result of that. Oh, you know, so on the flip side, it also is a very good thing to understand for the sake of your progress and your future life. Does that make sense? Lani, you'd like to ask?
This has been a huge pivotal point for me because I've had the had it all wrong.
Yeah.
When you say fix up the pure desire, just having that thought as I want to fix up, I want to make a pure desire is impure in itself.
No, it's a good thing, isn't it? Having a pure desire, wanting to actually have a pure desire. But how do you fix pure, how do you make impure desires pure?
Yeah.
Is the real question,
yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
And that means removing any selfishness from the desire.
Yeah.
Does it not?
Yeah.
And removing any selfish motivations from the desire.
Yeah.
Now, that's going to require working through some emotional issues, isn't it, generally? Selfish motivations for a desire usually come from a number of areas in our childhood, as all a part of our law-based hangover that we have. And we're going to have to, at some point, address them. And God's laws are all about addressing them, in fact. God's laws are correcting the desire in the end. Because God knows that if you can get the desire pure, then the outcome is always going to be pure.
Whereas I've been worried about the outcome and not looking at the real desire.
Correct, yeah, correct.
And it just doesn't work.
It doesn't work, no. In fact, this is why many people then start referring to the subconscious, you know, this sort of this subconscious driving your actions, the subconscious wanting you to do bad things and you're trying to do good things. Does that make sense? Well, once you've corrected your desire, do you think you need to try to do good things? Of course you don't. You just naturally do them. That's how it is. And then you don't have to think so much either about it. You don't have to go, is this outcome going to be good? I don't even think about the outcomes at all now. It's like, if I know my desire is pure, I just do it.
And it also leaves you open for possibilities, for God to bring you all these possibilities if your desire is pure.
Correct.
And all these things you couldn't have thought of anyway.
Correct.
Are going to start kind of happening.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just been remarkable sometimes what you learn, what you do learn in the process once you engage this aspect of desire. And obviously you can see that this desire thing, we've got to have some decent talks about this desire thing, right? We do. Yeah, that's true. Mm. So let's go back to the actual principles because we haven't finished them yet. So we've done the first three. You can see that self-responsibility is a measure for compensation. Right? So let's have a look at this. It forces the highest creation to be responsible and accountable for the way in which it uses the gift of free will. That's what it does. So without, you know, we had the responsibility principle. That's really only half of the responsibility equation, isn't it? The other half is providing a feedback mechanism so that the soul knows when it's attempting to get out of accountability and that it should actually get into accountability for its actions. Yeah. Now, can you see that if we were recognizing that every action that we take has accountability, we'd probably be a bit more circumspect, wouldn't we, about the decisions we make? Hmm. So it compensates consistently and predictably. What principle is that?
Permanence.
So it compensates with permanence according to the soul's actual level of self-responsibility in all situations. So in other words, if two people could be ever to be said to have the same self-responsibility and they engage the same action, it would be the same results every time. Right. So what does that tell us about diseases? That tells us that if I've got something like cancer in the left breast and a friend of mine had cancer in the left breast, then what does it tell us? That we both have exactly the same compensatory issues to work through. Exactly the same. Right. Okay. So the other principles. Now, we need to probably talk about a few notes about those principles. Now, I just want to get to those notes. I don't know if I've got them in my outline, so I'll just If I haven't got them, I'm going to get some of you to actually mention them for me. I'm pretty sure I have put them in here, so I've just got to jump to them. Here we go. Here's some notes, because this is where a lot of you had some struggles, right? Understanding how this works. Because on one hand, we're saying compensation works instantly, and then the other hand is saying, well, how does that work when we don't see an instant result, seemingly? And I say seemingly because most of us have not awareness enough to see the instant result. Right? So let's look at the notes about the principle, which you have in your outline as well. Sins committed by others that affect me attract pleasurable compensation and allowance towards me. Now, that's like saying, okay, I'm here, you decide to steal my car. There's a pleasurable compensation to me. How does that work? That's not what you feel in the moment, is it? It's like, damn that bastard, they stole my car. You know what I mean? It's not like pleasurable compensation towards me. That's what you're thinking, right? And this is also how we judge compensation. We basically judge compensation as on the physical level. When we see something happening, we want it to be a physical result, do we not? Well, in the case of someone stealing the car from me, his soul will be penalized in a corrective way against that thing, and it's instant. So in other words, there's an automatic degradation in his condition because of his unloving action. Automatic. Now, if he was sensitive emotionally, he would feel it. But the fact that he's gone and stole my car in the first place probably means that he's not sensitive emotionally. So he probably will not feel it at that moment, even though the compensation is instant. Does everyone get that? And the reason why he's not feeling it is because he's already got a desire to steal the car, which indicates that he already does not feel much at all about stealing. Otherwise, he would probably not steal in the first place, right? So, but from God's perspective, the soul has degraded. The compensation is applied to his soul immediately for the action that he has taken. So his soul now has degraded in condition immediately because of that action. The fact that he's not aware of it is immaterial. That's due to his detunement to other and openness to his emotional condition, isn't it? Which is a choice that he can personally make. So that, from God's perspective, that's immaterial. The actual degradation has occurred, and he will, at some point in the future, have to come to recognize the degradation that occurred through the act. Now, the majority of people on earth don't do it on earth, so they are forced into the process of recognition of every single sin. So if he stole 300 cars, he will have a list in front of him after he's passed of all the vehicles he stole, who he stole them from, and what happened to each one of their lives as a result of him stealing those vehicles. Does that make sense? And what unloving choices they even made as a result of him stealing those vehicles will be attributed to him as well. And that will be a list that he'll have to then compensate for one after the other, until he's done. Does that make sense to you? Peter, you'd like to ask?
Does the compensation go further, i.e. with his parents and the situation that got him there in the first place?
Of course it does. So let's say he grew up in this terrible environment and his parents taught him to steal. Almost every one of his actions is now not attributed to him so much as attributed to his parents. Interesting. But let's look at this one then in terms of how it affects me. I'm one of his victims. I had my car stolen. How does it affect me? Well, my soul is compensated now for every action I might potentially take as a result of him stealing the car. So let's say I get angry. Now, obviously, I'm out of harmony with love, but God actually compensates me for the fact that I'm getting angry about somebody else's sin that was committed towards me. And so there's less compensation required from me for that anger than there would normally be. Does that make sense? Because God knows that my anger was triggered by an unloving event that somebody else chose to engage. Does everyone get that? It doesn't mean, though, that I am absolved of the anger. It just means that I'm compensated for the fact that I engaged an unloving act that was triggered by somebody else's unloving act. Yeah. Ru, would you like to ask?
How does God know that?
How that happens?
No, how God knows that my anger was triggered by the act of another person?
Good question, but easy to answer. Remember, God measures, God's mathematical systems measure every single bit of energy that passes through you. So God knows both that the energy is anger, and he also knows the belief that drove it, because that's another form of energy that passes through you. The belief that somebody else harmed you, and then he measures that against the truth. Is it true that somebody else harmed you? And if it is true, then a compensatory effect occurs. Does that make sense? If it's not true, there's a double up of yours. So this is where many of you get out of harmony, because you have beliefs that somebody has hurt you when nobody has. And that actually means that you will be corrected twice. Once for believing that somebody has hurt you when they haven't, and the other for the actions that you took believing somebody hurt you when they hadn't. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. If we go to Elvira and then down to Adria at the front.
When you were answering Peter's question and you said that it was attributable to his parents, that would only be partly, wouldn't it?
Well, how much partly? Well, God knows exactly how much partly.
So
in some cases, it might be fully attributable to his parents. For example, let's say he was taught from a young age to steal, and also he had a mental disorder. Now, in that case, every single negative action he has taken will not be attributed to his soul. It'll be attributed to the soul of the parent.
But with, like, as a normal self-responsible adult, the actions that you take, like, they're mostly you, like...
Not always, are they? You have a... If you grow up believing that there's nothing wrong with stealing, right, then can you see to correct that action would take quite a lot of self-responsibility, right? So partly all of what you steal has to be attributed to the person who taught you that. You have a problem with that, Elvira.
Yeah. Well, like, okay, say you brought up to think that stealing's okay in your family.
Yeah.
There's a lot of other messages in society that say that it's not.
I haven't said that there isn't, have I?
So that means that that person is choosing to ignore...
Society's rules, I agree.
Society's rules, that means...
Which they might have also been taught to do from... The parent.
Okay. I have to think about all that, I think.
Yeah. Can you see that? You can see that it's fortunate that God measures it and not you. Because I reckon I'd get pretty harshly treated if it was you.
No, I agree. Because I feel like you're somehow letting me off the hook now.
No, God never lets anything off the hook. Can you see from my previous example of the man who stole every vehicle by his own will... that he's not getting let off the hook for any single thing that he's done. Not a single thing. But God gives positive compensatory benefits to those where other people have done the damage. And this is a part of the principle. And it's important that you see this, because if you don't see it, you'll start to believe that there's an injustice here somewhere. And there's not. There's no injustice in this law at all. It's perfectly adjusted, you know, like a finely tuned instrument.
It's lucky God's more loving than me, really.
Yeah. Okay. Yep, Claudia, and then come down to Adrian. Make her way back down to you.
How come we get that allowance from God, although we have attracted the event in the first place?
Well, God also considers that we have attracted the event in the first place, but one of the reasons why we might have attracted the event in the first place is because in our childhood, somebody did steal from us, or one of the reasons why it might be that we stole from others. Now, of course, God will measure that too. Does that make sense? Because every single thing is measurable from God's perspective. So can you see, nothing gets missed out with this law? Yeah.
Pretty cool.
So you can ask as many how comes and what fors as you want.
It's not going to change.
At the end of the day, everything's compensated for. Does that make sense?
Yeah, cool. Thank you.
Adrian, thanks. Down the front here, thanks. Just straight down, it's coming down.
Yeah, I'm not sure if it's the same question as Claudia. I'm just going to ask anyway. So if I steal your car, for example, and you get angry, why would your anger get this positive compensatory effects when you attracted the event as well? So if you attracted the event, is...
Well, it depends what caused the attraction of the event, as I said to Claudia. Right. So if my own actions in the past caused the degradation of my soul that created the attraction of the event, then naturally there would be no compensation for that. But if it's not my events of the past but somebody else's towards me that caused that emotion to exist inside of me, then they are going to get the degradation of their soul for creating that problem within me. So everything is finely tuned, finely honed down. You can, like I said, you can keep on asking these questions for the rest of the talk if you want, or you can learn more about it. But at the end of the day, it's all perfectly compensated for, right? Right. And can you see how little trust you have in God? Can you see these questions? You're just like, but what about this? But what about that? But what about this? Don't you think God is good? He knows that already. Given that he's infinite and he measures everything, don't you think he measures every single cause, every single effect? Don't you think he already knows? Obviously not, because otherwise you wouldn't be asking these questions, right? And this is something to realize. When we're asking these kind of questions, all we're really doing is demonstrating our lack of trust in God. That's all we're doing. But and therefore, you know, when I say the words to you, God is good, inside of you, you're going, no, he's not. Because it's the no, he's not that drives the questions. This lack of belief that God is good. Yeah? Mary, you'd like to?
Is it also that we're so used to this black and white, you're to blame and you're not? And you, because what I feel when you discuss responsibility and compensation, it's like a web of it's a myriad of variables that are all God can measure and know. And so there's compensation attributed to everyone in the situation in varying degrees and in varying positive or negative ways.
Correct. Yeah. Correct. There's so many variables that you do not consider. Like, for example, countries go to war. You do not consider how your fear contributes to a country going to war, even if you don't personally go to war. Even if you disagree with the country going to war, your fear still contributes to them going to war. So you're not measuring that, but God is. So every time a country goes to war, every single person in that country who actually has fear about their own safety and security has a negative compensation for that country going to war. And isn't that fair? Given the fact that they all probably, or half of them at least, voted for the person, most of them are agreeing with the action. Even if they're conscripted, they could choose to not be and be thrown in jail instead. But instead, what do? They go anyway. And even if all of that happens and they are conscripted and they refuse and they go to jail, still if they have some fear in them, there will be a negative compensation for it. But it won't be as much as the negative compensation for the others, obviously. See, this is where many of you are not seeing even the results of your fear. Remember, I raised Friday night in this group, how many of you are dictated to by fear of angry and abusive women? Remember that? Now, you can feel the mood is lightened significantly, can't you, in the audience? You can feel that, can't you? That tells me how much your fear has been affected by these people. Do you follow me? That tells me that. Now, your fear, which you refuse to get rid of, and which you therefore desire to hold on to, causes some of that suppression of you, of yourself. So can you blame those women totally for their action? No, you can't. Now, it would be different if you stood up to them. Now, you can blame them totally for their action. But if you don't, if you're not standing up to them and you're just going along with them, which most of you do, you're basically feeding the monster. But so surely the person who feeds the monster should be penalised for feeding the monster rather than the monster being penalised for getting bigger. Isn't that true? So what are we doing about that? Most of us, nothing. Because we think fear should be compensated for. Fear is a very, will receive a negative compensation. So them being present in the auditorium is a part of the attraction to help you address your fear. Now, hopefully what this procedure has done is demonstrated to you, number one, that somebody acted for you because you were too afraid to act, right? Now, that tells me that you need to learn that to act for yourself with regard to fear, right? Many of you refuse to do this. Also, it also tells me that you're open to the absorption of the projection because you get all suppressed. Most of, half of you were asleep for some of the time they were here. The sun Saturday was a terrible day. Getting anything out of you was like getting blood out of stone. Right? So that tells me that you were willing to accept the oppression rather than do something about it. Right? Which is a desire that is out of harmony with love, therefore a desire that will be compensated to correct. Correction will be applied. Part of your suppression on that day was a part of the correction God's supplying, showing you the negative results of you suppressing your fear and trying to act like it's not there while at the same time not doing anything with the people who were oppressing you. That makes sense? It's just an example. Okay, so let's go back to the notes because we haven't hardly done anything about them. The first one was challenging enough. Sins committed by me that affect others trigger a pleasurable compensation allowance towards others. Now, some of us will, does this mean we should go around hurting other people because they get pleasurable compensation for it? Of course not. How stupid would that be? I'm basically just telling you a truth, though. If you take an act that harms another person, whatever they do after that point is not all attributed to them. They get a pleasurable compensation in the sense of a, like some compensation for the fact that actually you triggered their behaviour. Now, you think how much this applies to parents with children. Whoa, it's massive. Massive. In fact, the majority of people who pass on this planet pass into the hells for no other reason that they treated their children in an unloving manner. Interesting. And why? Because what happens is anything that child does thereafter has to also partially be attributed to you because you haven't corrected their behaviour, you haven't taught them what love is about and what truth is about and the other principles about, you haven't taught them ethics or morality. Now, of course, if you didn't know it, which can't actually be said for the majority of you actually, but if you didn't know it, then it would be attributed to you, the person who caused you to not know it. But for the majority of us as adults, We often know when we're teaching our children wrong things. We often see the results in our children becoming unruly. We see the results of our own teaching of them, and we do nothing about it. We put all that on society, as we talked about in the human law, emotions and attitudes. We put the responsibility of addressing our teaching of our children in error onto society because we can't handle them anymore. And yet when we see the results, we should see, wow, maybe I've taught them some wrong things here. But we don't. We go and have another child and teach them the same thing. And another and another and another. There should be educational institutions, shouldn't there, for parents, don't you think? Isn't that one of the biggest problems on the planet? Surely we should create an institution that basically educates prospective parents. That would be a fantastic thing. How successful do you think that would be? Oh, I think it would be like, if you want to create a billion-dollar business tomorrow, get started on that one. Honestly, within 10 years, I bet you got a lot going on with a business in that regard. And I'm not saying do it for the money, because that would have a negative compensatory correction. Does that make sense? Yeah, so we need to grasp these principles better. Obviously, the sins committed by me attract a negative penalty towards myself. You know, most of us can see that one. And sins committed by any person trigger a negative penalty towards those who committed the sin, not towards the people who they affected. Right? Now, just go backwards. Good deeds committed by others that affect me, what happens there? Can you see, not only do they attract a positive compensation, a pleasurable compensation towards others, towards the person who did the good deed, but they also benefit the persons who have benefited from that deed. So it's very interesting. There's a double reward for good deeds. Isn't that interesting? You see, many of you are going, there's no point in doing a good deed. And I'm going, there's double rewards for doing a good deed. Not only is there a reward for the person who's done it, and oftentimes, and just bear this in mind, if the penalty goes to not only the person who you did the good deed for, I mean, let's look at it from a penalty perspective. If the penalty goes towards yourself for hurting another person, and also goes to yourself for that person hurting others as a result of you hurting them, can you see the good deed is also going to go towards helping that person, but also towards, if that person helps a whole heap of others, you get some of that reward too. It's like a pyramid scheme. Did you see that? It's like a pyramid scheme. And you could say that the penalties are an inverse pyramid scheme. You know, the opposite, you know. So we need to understand this, that the beauty of engaging good deeds not only affects just the person you're attempting to assist, but also affects you by every other person that person assists as a result of what you did. So there's a lovely example of that in the Robert James Lee's material. Right near the end in the gate of heaven, Aphra meets a man who materialized a body on earth and stopped him from committing suicide. What happened was the man, who's in the book, the name is Willamilly, he materialized a body on earth and he convinced, and Aphra was about to dive in the river and drown himself because he'd just had a broken relationship, right? But this man stopped him. He stopped him. He knew, obviously, what his intentions were, being a spirit. So he materialized the body and talked to him with the body about, you know, that desire, and pointed him in the direction of helping some other people. Then on top of that, a month later, he materialized another body and helped him show which people which people he would like him to help. Now Afra finished up arriving in the spirit world at the top of the first sphere in a pretty good condition, given the fact that he had many emotional injuries, right? He arrived in a pretty good condition because he helped people, right to the point where his own death was because of helping somebody that he didn't even know. And then when he got 31 years later, he met the person who saved him, which wasn't a person at all, it was a spirit. And he met him. And he says, and Willamilli says to Afra, "You're one of the crowns in my, you're one of my, the diadems in my crown." In other words, what he was saying there was, "You're one of the reasons why I'm in the position I am in now, because I helped you." Right? And not only by default did he help him, but Afra then went and helped a lot of other people, which were all also attributed to Willamilli, because he helped Afra. Isn't that lovely? Yeah. That's a pretty good pyramid scheme, I think. So can we see that we need to also start analysing these notes in a positive direction? Can you see we need to start seeing them instead of sins committed, we need to start good deeds. What happens with the good deeds? What happens there? And the law of compensation, which involves compensatory principles mixed with scope, hierarchy, and responsibility, that law actually gives positive rewards just as much as it gives corrective adjustments. And this is where we frequently do not consider this on earth, right? We don't consider it on earth. There's been many people in the spirit world who have arrived in the spirit world and they're like in the top of the first sphere or even in the early parts of the second sphere. And they're going, confused, you know. I didn't do anything fantastic to get here. And people have said to them, "You stayed with your wife for 50 years. And he said, "But I loved her." Interesting, hey? Is that why you stayed? That's what you're rewarded for. The fact that you loved. Not that you stayed and you didn't want to stay, but the fact that you stayed because you loved her. And in fact, if you really loved her and she didn't want to be with you, you would have left her. Right? But also they did things like, you know, when somebody needed shoes, they took their shoes off of their own feet and gave them the shoes, even when that was the only pair of shoes they had. And a few months later, they got back some shoes. And that's all I did. But in the first century, I said, God will consider it as if you've done it to me. And what I was saying there was that God examines each one of those things and basically says that if you treat one of his children kindly with compassion, then it's like you've treated God with kindness and compassion. That's how God feels. So interesting principles, these compensation principles, yes? Really lovely principles. So let's just pop back to our normal presentation. It just goes back to that. So compensation principles ensure that I become aware of and are compensated for the manner in which I engage self-responsibility. They link scope, hierarchy, governance and responsibility to form a foundation for soul-specific principles. So when we talk about 2 days' time, we start talking about soul-specific principles, you'll see that compensation and these other order-based principles, along with scope, one of the foundation principles, form the basis of the highest principles that govern the soul. Now, honestly, when it comes to this principle, we are just right up the creek, you know, with the way we see things. You know, we've got issues like feeling that disobedience will never be penalized, but we've also got feeling that obedience from the heart, from the desire, will never be rewarded, We've got that problem too, haven't we? We feel we can sin with impunity, but we also feel that doing good deeds, as the saying goes on earth, no good deed goes unpunished, is what we think. Unpunished. We think that every good deed will be punished. That's how bad it is. That's how distorted our viewpoint of the compensation principles are. We even have slogans for it on earth. Right? So we often have this feeling on earth, don't get involved. You get involved, you know, you stick your nose in where it's not wanted, you're going to get it bitten off. That's how we see, right? But that's not how God sees good deeds. It's just how people on earth who are in error see them, right? Now we could make huge long lists here, couldn't we? Feeling that we only sin if we act. Majority of us have had that problem, have we not? And also feeling that we only benefit if we act as well. So many of us feel that the benefit comes, I don't want to act, but I'm being told that I should. So what do? I act. And there's no reward. With this principle, there's no reward because it wasn't the pure desire that drove my actions. Does that make sense? Now, there might be benefits to other people, but they won't be attributed to me because my desire was unloving, driving my action. Right? So while me engaging a good deed for the sake of someone else, even though I don't want to, doesn't benefit me, it still benefits the other person, and you will be rewarded for the fact that it benefited the other person, but you'll be penalized for the fact that you did it out of harmony with a pure desire. So what's the net result? Reward there, penalization there, correction there. It's probably going to be the same, isn't it? Close to. So this is the interesting thing about this compensatory principle, is that you can see that God measures everything, not just what you imagine he measures. Yeah. So obviously we can complain about the negative compensation effects too that we have created through our own choices. Many people on earth do this, right? I'm in this abusive relationship. I'm complaining about the abuse constantly, but I'm choosing to stay in the relationship. There's an example of complaining about something that you created that you could choose quite easily to uncreate, to get out of. Right? But we don't. You know why? Because in this case we go, no, my fear, I'm afraid. And as if fear justifies every unloving act. That's what we do. So again, compensation. Fear, compensation. Every time my motivation is fear, what's God's law trying to do? Correct my fearful motivation and bring it into harmony with love. That's what it's trying to do. Yeah. So it's a wonderful, this principle is a wonderful principle to understand. So what I'd like to do is address some of your questions about it, and we'll see how we go with these questions. Katrina, where are you? And there, so we start with you, question number one of yours, and then Anna, question number one of yours. So if you'd put your hand up, Anna, for...
What is the time frame in which God applies compensation principles, either a reward or correction?
The time frame is instant. Now, the fact that we don't feel it as instant is an indication of what? Our lack of emotional sensitivity to the instant reward. That's what it's about. So many of us on the earth lack emotional sensitivity to the instant soul-based reward, and we're also searching for physical external rewards, right? But we're talking here about soul-based compensation, so it's a soul-based reward, which often then results in physical rewards, but those physical rewards come over time. Now, just there's somebody else, I just want to jump to it, related to that question. Joyce, can we just jump to Joyce, two back? Because this is about the question about being instant in a way, isn't it? So if you could ask your question, Joyce. Joyce, it's your first question, I think. Yep. Joyce, one.
If the law of compensation is immediate on the soul, how soon does this manifest in the body and one's life? And is there always an obvious connection to the unloving behaviour?
Yes. So the answer is yes. The law of, as I've said to Katrina, the law of compensation is immediate. The results are immediate. Then the question becomes, well, that's immediate to the soul. What kind of flow-on effect does that have to the bodies? Remember, we've both got a spirit body and a physical body. What happens there? There must be a brightening of the condition of the soul, if it's a positive reward, for example. So let's have a look at what happens. So here we've got our soul, and it's connected to four bodies, is it not? Is that not true? Right? So now we've got, and we will learn that it's not quite connected like that. It's actually overcloaks those bodies, of course, but we'll learn that in the next few days. So here we go. We've got the four bodies. Now, one half of the soul decides to do something that's good. That God's laws appraise. Remember, the edge of God's laws measure everything. So God's laws are appraising that it's good. Yeah? So it's good. Now, of course, that good thing might have affected 10 other people, 20 other people as well, which will all be, there'll be a positive compensation upon this soul, will there not? So it will all go to this soul, and maybe I shouldn't use the cross there. It's a positive compensation, so we give him a big blue tick. Does that make sense? Positive compensation to the soul. Now, can you see that that soul is connected to those four bodies? Spirit, physical, spirit, physical. There's got to be a flow-on effect. Remember, when your brightness improves, your energy systems improve. If your energy systems improve, then it also means that the energy system of your soulmate has got a potential improvement. And if the energy system improves, then depending on the flow between the two halves of the soul, it will affect the other half as well as your half. And there will be a flow-on effect, firstly, to the spirit body. And the way these bodies are connected are not directly like that, is it? It's more like this, isn't it? Right? Where you've got a silver cord there, a golden cord going to the soul, the energy system, and so the silver cord. Now, how fast do these bodies repair? Well, this thing happened instant. So here it was instant. Within 7 hours, usually the spirit body repairs itself. And within 7 years, the physical body repairs itself of that specific injury. Does that make sense? So can you see one of the advantages of being a spirit? Not that I suggest you go there beforehand. Because that would be breaking the life principle. Okay. So now we have an adjustment of our spirit body in positive direction and a flow-on effect in our physical body. And the reason why it takes 7 years, and this is assuming none of God's love is involved. This is assuming that it's just your own action. So this is not involving God's love healing you or anything like that. This is just the results of your own loving action. That's it. Do you follow me? You'll get a positive reward in your spirit body within 7 hours and a positive reward in your physical body within 7 years. And that's because the cell replication process for different parts of your body happened at different speeds. So the damage that was done, remember we said, well, way back in the life principles, remember we talked about the DNA and the base pairs that were in error, that were damaged, And some of those base pairs are obviously reflecting different emotional conditions that we are experiencing. Those emotional conditions are changed, therefore the base pairs repair, and we'll have a subsequent result in the replication process of the cell. But bearing in mind there's billions and billions of cells, it's going to take a little bit of time. Does it follow? Yeah? Good. Obviously the opposite is also true, is it not? So if this becomes a big red, then the results of that will also be happening within 7 hours in the spirit body and within 7 years in the physical body. Right. Can you see there's a big benefit to feeling your soul? Because you'll know it instantly then, rather than waiting 7 hours or 7 years to find out. Do you follow? So isn't it better to feel your soul and know than it is to wait and measure before you know? Like, imagine that. I do a good deed today and I go, okay, I've got to write down the date. In 7 years' time, I have a look at which part of my body has actually improved. Now, good luck with that, because there's probably a whole heap of other parts of your body in that time that have degraded, and you might have a bit of difficulty measuring. So, but if you felt it in your soul instantly, bang, you know. I know that's benefited me. I can feel the positive rewards for taking that action now. And then you know to repeat these actions as well, don't you? You know that these actions are repeatable. Yep. Does that make sense? So if we come back, where was I? I can't remember where I was. Anna, just let me find you. Anna, yes. I'm needing the one before Katrina. So you now have your answer. It's instant. And Joyce now has her answer of how long it takes to get the measure of it into the physical and spiritual aspects of your life, a spiritual body, which is metaphysical. Does that make sense? G'day. Let's move across to Anna. Number one, thanks.
In the objectives that you listed,
that's not my number one.
Sorry, no, I was just saying the sentence that brought the question about.
Oh, okay, fire away. Yeah, fire away.
So yeah, one of the objectives is to educate the highest creation that the gift of free will brings responsibilities.
Yes.
And the question is, why are some of us so inherently afraid of responsibility?
Yeah, good question, isn't it? Why are we afraid of responsibility? Well, again, it's one of those questions that are driven by, you know, potentially thousands of reasons. But can you see, basically, it all boils back to something that happened in our childhood experience generally that caused us to fear taking responsibility for ourselves in all ways, right? There's got to be events in our childhood that have caused us to fear responsibility. Or there has to be events in our childhood that caused us to believe that someone else should take responsibility. So this is a trouble with parental upbringing. They often bring us up in a way to believe in one of three different ways when it comes to responsibility. So usually there's one of these three different ways. Of course there's more, but usually it's one of these three. The first thing is be responsible. So this is the parent's statement to the child. Be responsible. I'll just call it responsible like that for the parent. So in other words, the parent wants the child to be responsible for the parent. Very common, is it not? You want to be responsible for the parent's emotions, for the parent feeling good about themselves, and so forth. Can you see that places a burden on the child beyond its own self-responsibility, which naturally would mean that the whole word responsibility now has quite evil connotations to you? Can you see that? It would do, wouldn't it? If the parent is asking you to be responsible for their feelings, then the child is already struggling for responsibility of its own feelings because it hasn't learnt self-responsibility yet. And now it's being forced into being responsible for not only its own feelings, but also for somebody else's. Right? So that's going to be a problem, isn't it? For the child. Yeah? Then there's be responsible, and many of you could list some of these, couldn't you? What different options there would be here. So be responsible for what?
For yourself.
Well, is that what they really think? Don't they believe being responsible for yourself is a bad idea? This is a whole concept of family, isn't it? Family basically says you need the family to survive. And this is what most parents are teaching their children. You need me to survive. Your life is dependent upon my welfare. What does that teach the child? The child grows up believing that it can't survive without the parent. Can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
So if I grow up believing I can't survive without the parent, what am I going to do? I am going to start making decisions and actions that put responsibility on my parent. And my parent most likely will take responsibility for many of my actions. So for example, I go out praying the car. Parent says, no worries, just give you another one. Right? Isn't that going to cause also you to believe that taking self-responsibility, you shouldn't have to do it? Somebody else should do it for you, right? Now, what I would suggest you do as a personal activity is to look at all the ways in which responsibility, your parent has taught you, the different ways, and there's many, many ways that the parent has taught you to not take responsibility for yourself.
That's really useful. Thank you.
Does that make sense? Because if you do that, you can start looking at your resistance to the whole concept of self-responsibility, which also will make you resistive. If you're resistive to self-responsibility, you will also be resistive to the compensation principle. You see? You're going to want to start taking credit for what others did, and you also want to start denying responsibility for what you did. Because of these things that have gone on with your parents. So can you see there's a lot of insidious manipulation that occurs because of the parents' belief of love, what love should do as a parent, is manipulates our concepts of self-responsibility so much that in the end we're so distorted that we make ourselves, we want to take responsibility for what nice things other people did. And I see many of you doing this all the time. Like, I see a spirit give you a message to do something nice. You go and do something nice, you get a reward, and then you think that it was all you. But who told you to do it? Who do you think is going to get the reward? The spirit who told you, right? Now, sure, you'll get a reward for the action you took. You obviously agreed and you took the action. But the main reward goes to the person who conceived the idea. And that was not you, that was the spirit with you. Does that make sense? So many times we want to say that we are the person who accomplished this when obviously we're not considering everything, right?
Mm. Thanks.
So it's a good question. Let's move on. Can we go to, am I going time-wise? I'm not going very well. Is that right, baby? I'm like 1 minute to go. Mama.
Last time I just sped through. I'm fine to do that for the review. Do you know what I mean?
Well, I'd like to just maybe answer one or two more if that's all right with you guys.
I've got tons of time, babe. For my review, so.
I want to go to Max's. Can we go to Max's question? If we have Max down here.
Is the reason self-responsibility is a measure for compensation Because once a person takes personal responsibility for their sin, they have a sincere desire to correct the cause and the effect of their sin. Therefore, they are already doing what compensation would have done.
Yeah. Can everyone see that? Isn't that a good reflection on your part? Yes, it is very right. The reason self-responsibility is used as the measure is precisely for that reason. You can see that if you take personal responsibility for your sin, then obviously you're automatically involved in the correction of yourself. Right? Which is really what God is trying to achieve here, is he not? He's trying to write the law in your heart. So he's trying to place the concept of the principles in your heart. How does he do that? By making you a self-responsible being and then measuring your self-responsibility against the operation of the law. So yes, exactly right. That reflection is exactly correct. Wonderful reflection, Max. Doesn't that show also that the opposite is true? And if we replace the word sin with good deed, can you see that it also corrects our or rewards us for the good deeds and shows how big the rewards are for the good deeds, which also then encourages us by our own desire to imagine good deeds and to carry them out. So it has the positive effect on good deeds, just as it has the other positive effect on sin. Yeah. Clever, eh? Gee, God's clever, isn't he? Now, just one more question. We'll have to end it there. Can I go to Paige, question one for you, Paige. Yes, thank you. Have you got your stuff with you there? Yep. She's up the back with the mic. Thanks.
Please elaborate on the objective to educate the highest creation that the gift of free will brings responsibilities.
Yes. Now, this is interesting because it just sort of elaborate a bit more on free will. Remember in the previous Q&A on the human law hangover, Rachel asked that question about like free will and isn't somebody encroaching on your free will. The reality is God has given you free will to do whatever loving thing you wish to do. Right? But he hasn't given you free will to do whatever unloving thing you wish to do. While you are able to do whatever unloving thing you wish to do, God is providing some kind of restriction upon that. And God must do this in order to maintain order in his universe. Because if he did not place a restriction on your unloving use of will, he would then be impacting upon other people's free will. So many of you forget that it's not the gift of free will was given to all humanity, not just to you. And the gift of free will is given to all humanity equally, not more to you and less to someone else. And so all of God's laws are set up in such way that your free will is measured equally with another person's. So when you are acting out of harmony with their operation of their free will, you are naturally breaking the law. And you can claim that you've got free will to do it, but the reality is God's laws are going to restrict it because you are now not being equal in the way in which you're exercising your will and valuing your will over others. So it's very important to understand that underlying principle. So we need to come to understand and value our personal will the same as we value somebody else's. Now, can you see straight away, if I desired to do that, I would never force another person through manipulation, coercion, or any other way. I would never force another person to take an action that I want them to take. I would only inform them of the truth and let them take the actions they wish to take. Can you see that? If I valued their will as much as my own. So many of you come up to me and say things like, what do you think I should do in the future? And I'm going, hang on a sec. Now, if I answer this question and say what I think you should do for the future, I am now basically not valuing your ability to make your own choice. So all I can really say is inform you. So I say something like, what does God want you to do for the future? Wouldn't you be wise to discover what that might be? Or doesn't God want you to follow your desires in harmony with love? What are your desires that are in harmony with love? Why don't you do those? Isn't that the only answer I can give? If I give any other answer, what am I doing? I'm now impacting your free will decision, which potentially is going to result in a consequence for my soul. You see? So this is why I'm very circumspect about many of your questions. And this is why all I'm doing is advising you based upon the law about what can be done, rather than telling you what you should be doing. Does that make sense? So all I can say to you is, if you're breaking law, you're going to cause a lot of penalty. If you're breaking the law and affecting this room, then all I can do is say, stop affecting this room. You need to go because you're affecting this room. But I can't control your desire to do the right thing or the wrong thing. That's up to you. You need to make choices and decisions there. And a self-responsible person would do so. Whereas a person who's not self-responsible will always try to put the decision on somebody else. And we've had a lot of problems with that in the past, where you are trying to put the decision-making upon me so that you can avoid the responsibility of the outcome. But I also observe that when you have a good outcome, you want to take the credit for it too, right? So that's an issue that needs to be addressed. And you can see, if you were fully self-responsible, you would be able to take the credit for the things that you actually did do that were good. And you should be responsible and be corrected for the things that you did not take responsibility for that, or did do that were out of harmony with love. Can you see that? Yeah. So another wonderful principle, is it not? Clever, thank God, leading us to what we're going to cover in our next set of principles, actually. Our next set of principles, remember, are four principles: will, desire, redemption, and transformation. Now, can you see compensation obviously is going to have a lot involved in desire and a lot involved in redemption? So this is a interesting thing that we're now building upon these principles and seeing how further principles can be constructed by God in order to give benefits to the human soul that obviously no other creation is able to receive, because they don't have the gift of free will and self-awareness. Yeah. Okay, well, thank you for your time with the compensation principles. Thanks, guys. Thank you. You've been a very engaged audience today, so I'd like to congratulate you on that, but also consider, I wonder why that's the case. You know, some of it's got to do with that oppressive air about us that we accede to because of our fears, right? And we take away the oppressive air and we're buoyant again. Put the oppressive air back, what's going to happen? Well, it depends on your desire, what you do with that next time, doesn't it? Because there's going to be times you're in an oppressive environment. What are you going to do with it? This is about your desire. What's going to come next is Mary is going to do a review of the order principles with you, along with some of the other sessions we've had, and then give you some homework. Now, homework is, as you already know, very similar to your first bit of homework that you had in the first session, along with some additions about self-responsibility, which you can see is quite essential. So that's why we put those additions in. So if we can come back at 15:20, 20 past 3, and Mary will get started on her presentation with you.